And can I welcome everybody to this, the fourth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? Yes. Yep, we are all agreed. The second item on our agenda is to agree to take any subsequent draft reports on the 2020-21 audit of the Crofting Commission in private. Do members agree to that? Agreed. Yep, we have assent to that. Thank you. Well, the principal item of our session this morning is to take evidence on the administration of Scottish Income Tax 2020-2021 report. And I'm particularly pleased to welcome once again with us in the committee room the Auditor General of Scotland, Stephen Boyle. And Stephen will be joined online by the Audit Director of Audit Scotland, Mark Taylor. But I'm also particularly pleased to welcome to the Scottish Parliament Public Audit Committee Gareth Davis, who's the Comptroller and Auditor General of the National Audit Office. And Gareth Davis is joined this morning by Darren Stewart, who's the Audit Director of the NAO. I think this is the first time Mr. Davis has given evidence to this Public Audit Committee, and it's unfortunate that we're only able to take your evidence, Mr. Davis, online this morning, but I do hope that sometime in the not too distant future we will be able to welcome you into the Scottish Parliament and to be able to meet the Public Audit Committee in person. I want to begin by inviting Stephen Boyle to give a short opening statement, after which I will come to the Comptroller and Auditor General from the NAO to then give an opening statement too. But Auditor General, over to you.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Scottish income tax remains a key part of the package of new financial powers implemented as a result of the 2012 and 2016 Scotland Acts. The purpose of today's session is to look at the administration of Scottish income tax. The reports which the committee has before it relate to 2020-2021, and this was the fourth year in which the full amounts of non-savings, non-dividend tax collected by HMRC is payable to the Scottish Government. It's also the third year that HMRC has published Scottish income tax outturns in its accounts. These outturn figures relate to 2019-20 and the difference between actual UK and Scottish tax outturns and the amounts forecast at the time are then adjusted to the 2022-23 budgets, known as a budget reconciliation. The reconciliation for the 2019-20 outturns will result in a budget reduction in 2022-23 of £34 million. HMRC's annual accounts also include an estimate of Scottish income tax for 2021, but this does not yet affect the Scottish budget. HMRC collects and administers Scottish income tax as part of the overall UK tax income tax system, and the NAO audits HMRC's accounts, and the Comptroller and Auditor General is responsible for reporting to the Scottish Parliament on HMRC's administration. Convener, I report to this committee as part of an additional assurance process on the NAO's work, in line with a recommendation dating back to 2014 that the previous Public Audit Committee made, and I also explain some of the impacts that it has on the Scottish budget. In summary, my report says that I'm satisfied that the NAO's audit approach was reasonable and covered the key audit risks. I'm also satisfied that the findings and conclusions of the Comptroller and Auditor General's report are reasonably based. The CNAG has concluded that the outturn to the Scottish on Scottish income tax was fairly stated, and this therefore provides the Scottish Parliament with valuable assurance over this aspect of the Scottish budget. As ever, Convener, we look forward to answering the committee's questions this morning, but as you outlined, I'll hand now briefly to Gareth. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener and members. Just to explain my role in this process very briefly, as the Auditor General has just said, I'm required to report to the Scottish Parliament on the outturn for, in this case, 2019-20, and HMRC's estimates of the revenue from income tax in Scotland for 2021. We've also examined the HMRC's administration of the system as it applies to Scottish income tax, and the costs recharged by HMRC to the Scottish Government under the service level agreement. As the Auditor General has just said, in terms of the outturn and estimate, the methodologies have remained broadly similar to previous year, and I've concluded that both of those are reasonable. This is the seventh annual report that we've produced, with HMRC's administration of Scottish income tax now having reached essentially an implementation of business as usual. Those rules and processes are well embedded, and the picture painted by my report is one of consolidation on the progress made in previous years. Clearly, HMRC's focus now has to be on refining the processes that it has in place to maintain an accurate and complete record of the Scottish taxpayer population, as well as continuing to monitor the risk of non-compliance that may or may not arise as a result of divergence between UK and Scottish tax rates. I'm sure the committee will be interested in the impact of COVID-19 on the figures set out in the report and in subsequent years. And I think it's fair to say in summary that COVID-19 has had less of an impact on the collection of income tax in the UK as a whole and in Scotland than might have been expected at the start of the pandemic. And in fact, the outturn is slightly higher than the estimate for 1920 and represents an increase on the previous year. And the estimate for 2021 also represents a further increase. I think in the context of a pandemic, that's maybe slightly surprising, but also very welcome in terms of tax collection. As I say, this is consistent with what we've seen in our audit of HMRC for the UK as a whole, where COVID support schemes have stabilised employment. Clearly, with those schemes now having ended, there'll be a lot of attention at HMRC on the impact on tax payment rates, the level of taxpayer debt to HMRC, and the impact of all of that on the amount finally collected. My team and I have worked closely with the Auditor General for Scotland and colleagues at Audit Scotland throughout our audit on this matter, and I'm very grateful for their collaboration on the work. I'm looking forward to answering your questions. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much indeed, both Mr. Davis and Auditor General, for your opening statements. We have, as you would expect, got quite a significant number of questions. And I just want to begin, Mr. Davis, where you left off, which is that it does seem a little bit counterintuitive, doesn't it, that at a time when there was a huge collapse in the economy, GDP and GVA and all these measures of economic performance, that the estimates suggest an increase in the tax take over the period when the pandemic was at its height. And this again is based on the words that we keep coming across, our estimates and samples and assumptions. Can we rely on those estimates being accurate?
Well, I think you're right to be cautious because clearly the full impact of the pandemic are not so much on the assessment of tax liabilities, because clearly there's more clarity on the amount of tax actually owed by taxpayers through the self-assessment scheme and the PAYE scheme. It's more the impact on collection of tax due. And bear in mind that the outturn that we're reporting on here, so the most accurate figure, if you like, in this set of figures is for 2019-20, which most of that was pre-pandemic. And so the first full year of the pandemic's impact is 2021. Now, the estimate is robust, as we've seen, and is showing a healthy level of tax collection. But just a note of caution that the risk of higher levels of non-collection, higher levels of non-compliance, isn't completely eliminated yet. Now, HMRC has, as I'm sure we'll go on to discuss, has made some reasonable estimates the impact of those factors. So they are taken into account in coming up with this estimate. But I would say there's a higher level of risk than normal just because of the, until we've seen exactly how much tax is collected rather than assessed as due, we won't know the full picture. So I'm sure we'll get into some more of the detail on how those estimates have been constructed. But I think on your broader point about the impact of the pandemic on the economy, The total tax take for the UK has reduced, but it's not income tax. Its other taxes have suffered the brunt of that, particularly VAT. The biggest single ball in the tax take for the UK is on VAT, where a 15 billion reduction is anticipated. Reductions in also in hydrocarbon duties, another significant amount, and some other business taxes. But income tax on individuals has held up. And I think the answer to why that is the COVID support schemes that were put in place, both the furlough scheme and the self-employed income scheme, heavily protected levels of income through the worst phases of the pandemic, and has therefore resulted in higher levels of income tax than might have been expected.
Thank you. I mean, and is it the case then that in both PAYE receipts and self-assessment receipts, they have they've grown according to the figures that are presented in this report? Is that correct?
That's correct. Yes.
Okay. And there was, if I remember rightly, a postponement of the deadline for self-assessment tax returns. Do we know whether that's had any impact on collection rates?
Well, it certainly had an impact on the amount owed by taxpayers to HMRC. And at this point, I'm talking UK-wide because we haven't done a separate analysis of tax collection as regards Scottish taxpayers. But we've no reason to think that the picture is different in the various parts of the UK at this stage. We reported separately as part of our audit of HMRC. We reported separately on the very large growth in tax debt owed by individuals to HMRC through the course of the pandemic. As you say, payments were allowed to be deferred. And not surprisingly, that led to a significant increase in the total amount owed, peaking in the late summer of 2020. Since then, it's been falling as people realised they could actually pay their tax due, again, partly because of the economic support schemes in place at the time. But the amount still outstanding relating to 1920 and 2021 is higher than it had been pre-pandemic. So HMRC still has a major job in collecting the outstanding amounts. And of course, the longer they remain due, the harder they are to collect in general, because people have to keep up with their current tax bills, let alone pay arrears from previous years. So actually, your equivalent committee in Westminster held a specific hearing on the collection of outstanding tax debt by HMRC and is reporting on that shortly.
Thanks, Mr. Davis, and we will look forward to that. I want to turn now to an area which I will ask Stephen Boyle about as well, and that is, again, one of the things which is, I think, concerning this committee a little bit is the extent to which we are still reliant on estimates, samples and assumptions rather than hard data. And I guess the question, Mr. Davis, that we've got is, after this system of a Scottish income tax arrangement has been in place now for 3 years, why is it that we are still so reliant on samples, estimates and assumptions rather than relying on 3 years worth of Scottish income tax outturn information? And I will ask Mr. Davis first, and then I will come to Stephen Boyle second.
Yes, I think some element of estimation is inevitable in a system of this kind. But the challenge is to make that as small as possible, I think. The reason I think some element is always likely to be included is just because of timing, essentially. The bulk of the figures in the outturn for 2019 are certain and are known, so the vast majority is based on accurate data. But because the final tax take depends on the effectiveness of recovery action, tackling non-compliance, pursuing difficult cases, sometimes through the tribunals and so on. All of that takes a long time and isn't complete by the date that these estimates have to be reached for the purposes of reporting to the Scottish Parliament. So it's those areas where there is still recovery action outstanding, where you have to estimate the likelihood of success and the amount that will be collected through those cases. that's the prime area that will always be difficult to resolve in the time available before these figures have to be reached. But just to assure the committee that the vast majority of the numbers here are based on actual tax returns, money received and collected.
Thank you. And I think, Mr. Boyle, you raised this in your commentary on the NAO report. So I wonder whether you want to give us your views on this.
Many thanks, Convener, actually. And I think the headline from our perspective, our work, is that we are satisfied and with the approach that the NAO have taken. We have, through our own work, content with the judgments that our NAO colleagues have made. By way of the circumstances around the estimate, a couple of points I would maybe make, actually, and Gareth touched on one of these already, is that there's undoubted volatility by virtue of the pandemic. And whilst the estimates are reasonable, we don't yet know with sufficient accuracy what might come down the line by further challenges to the estimate, the tax take, individuals' behaviours as well. It's touched on in aspects of the report as well, Convener, that there are still risks to the tax take in the future. A couple of factors. One is the divergence that we're seeing already through the different tax regimes in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK, and that might yet lead to changes in behaviour, which I'm sure the committee might want to come back to. Other aspect of assurance that's perhaps helpful is that looking at the estimate and comparing it to the Scottish Fiscal Commission, they are relatively close. So you know, there's an element of additional validation there that you can see that although there is uncertainty that through HMRC's own estimates, those of the Fiscal Commission and then the associated assurance activity that our NAO colleagues have undertaken, I think there is as much confidence as is available, Convener, that the estimate is reasonably based.
Okay, thank you. And just one final question from me before I open it up to the rest of the committee, and that is, I mean, do you get any sense that as this is quite a new arrangement and is evolving and we are learning to some extent as we go along, do you know, Gareth Davis, whether the HMRC does have any plans to change its approach in the future based on the extent to which it's reliant on estimates for the reports that we get as a Scottish Parliament on the position of income tax take in Scotland?
Well, I think from our work with HMRC on this, it's clear that they do keep the entire calculation under review with particular focus on those areas where they have to include adjustments and estimates. So most of these adjustments and estimates are small compared to the overall figure, but because they require judgment to be applied by HMRC, they do review those, and I think it's fair to say we do see a mindset of continuous improvement there. They're very keen to make sure that the estimates use the best available information. They challenge whether previous approaches have been accurate enough, and will come forward with suggested changes where they think that will improve the quality. So we've seen that over the recent years, and we think that's a healthy approach. Clearly there's governance, HMRC doesn't do this on its own, there's governance between HMRC and the Scottish Government to test whether the approach is sound and to sign off on any methodology changes that are proposed. And so that does require the agreement of both parties before those are approved and implemented. So again, I think that's a good control over the development of the methodology here. But in answer to your main question, I think we do see evidence that HMRC is keen to improve this over time and takes quite a lot of pride in the accuracy of its estimates as well. And so is keen to understand anything that departs from assumptions they've made and will look to make proposed changes as a result.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I'm now going to invite Colin Beattie to ask a series of questions, I think, Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Davis, I've been involved in this committee since the Scottish tax was introduced several years ago. I'll ask you a very simple question first, and I'd like to focus more on the actual report. One of the things that jumps out is the increase in the number of missing Scottish postcodes, which has increased by 70%. Now, it's a small proportion of the taxpayer population, but it could be, for example, if there's a large number of high net worth individuals in there, it could have a significant effect on the collection of tax. So what is it that's actually behind that increase? What's driving this error?
I'll bring in my colleague, Darren Stewart, if I may, on that, who oversaw the detailed work on this, who might be better placed to know any further detail on that. Darren.
Thank you, Gareth. We did pose this question to HMRC in conducting our work. I don't think there is clarity on HMRC's part around exactly what is driving the increase in missing postcodes. I think the thing I would point back to, and I think we do reflect this in the report, is that it does casework around these missing postcodes. And as a result of that, where the missing postcodes relate to taxpaying Scottish individuals, so those in employment or with pension arrangements and things of that nature, it does update its records to make sure that the correct amount of tax is being collected. So I think the trend is something that we observed and played back to the department, but I think the assurance is that for those where there is an impact on the tax collection, that some remediating action has been taken.
But do we have any idea at all what the impact on the actual revenues that are being collected might be?
So I think from a revenue perspective, I think from the work we've done with HMRC, we have a relative degree of comfort that those missing postcodes aren't driving significant understatement, I guess, is what we're particularly interested in here, in the revenue collected. But we have suggested that some analysis should be done to identify the root causes as part of the continuous improvement that Gareth referred to earlier.
So you're satisfied that HMRC are taking steps to deal with this?
I think so, based on the work that we undertook.
You think so? Do we know, is this going to be a recurring incident?
This is going to be a key focus of our forthcoming report for 21-22. It's an area that we have pointed out to HMRC, and we will be investigating with them in preparing that report.
I mean, it must indicate a flaw in the process, surely.
I think the key thing here is to identify the root cause and take steps to address that. And that's something we'll be taking a keen interest in for our 21-22 report.
Since it's been happening every year now, since the institution of this system, it must be something endemic to the system.
It's difficult to say without that analysis having been undertaken, but I think it's something clearly we are keenly interested in and will be taking.
If it happens every year, clearly it's a flaw with the system, surely.
I guess what we point to in the report is, as you said, this is, in relative terms, a small number of individuals compared to the overall 2.5 million Scottish taxpayer population, but in the context of a system which is maturing, as you say, then these are the marginal gains that we would expect HMRC to be looking at to see what continuous improvement can be taken forward.
And if I could add, from our work on similar systems elsewhere in government, this is a data quality issue at heart. And these large data collection systems require continual effort to maintain data quality. You might think that once you've got a postcode correct, then you can be assured that it stays correct, but that's not always the case with these systems, because records might be updated for other changes and inadvertently errors made on the postcode field. I think the important thing is, does HMRC have sufficient checks in place to identify where these errors arise, and then a robust system for correcting them? Data quality issues will arise always in systems of this kind. So the question is how good your system for detecting these things and then correcting them quickly. And that's what we'll focus on in our work.
Coming to the broad report itself, the convener has already highlighted the multiplicity of references to estimates and so forth. And that's not terribly encouraging when you're trying to plan expenditure against the likely income that you're going to get from taxation. What disappoints me is when the system first came in, when the Scottish rate of income tax came in, it was a bit of a shambles, to be honest, the first year or two, but we kind of expected that. What I don't see is the improvements and the elimination of recurring problems since then. I would have thought as the system refines itself, as HMRC identifies the weak points and the variables in this, that they would work to eliminate that. I don't see that happening. I'm seeing the same stuff again and again and again. So you may think it's still relatively early years, but I would have hoped that some of this, these anomalies would have been eliminated by now.
I think my overall view is that the system for establishing the outturns is now robust and is giving you reliable data. I think we've tried to explain in the report why it will never be 100% predictable or accurate. In answer to the convener's questions earlier, I was explaining why there will always be a need for estimates in this process, and by definition, estimates will have a margin of error built into them. The question is this giving a meaningful outturn figure that can be relied on for budgeting purposes, as you say? And I think in the last few years, we have seen a reduction in the variance of the outturn to the from the original estimate. We do point out in the report that in comparison to equivalent outturns, the level of accuracy here has been reasonably high in recent years. So the 2018-19 outturn, so the year before the one we're looking at, was 0.9% lower than the estimated amount. The final outturn for 19-20 is 1.1% higher than the equivalent estimate. So around about 1%, actually in a different direction over those 2 years. Given, as I say, the inevitability of some level of estimation in this, I don't think that's a surprising or an unreasonable level of variation. Clearly, the challenge is to make that as small as possible. But I don't think we're dealing here with a system that's giving figures that can't be relied on. I think the system is as good as its current approach can make it. Bearing in mind, though, the need for annual improvement every year to spot trends and to deal with them.
1% equate to approximately the same as the UK figure?
Well, of course, we don't actually have that calculation here because that isn't used for the same purpose in the UK budget. But in terms of the, I'll ask Darren if he's got any better data than that for the UK as a whole.
Publish the relative quality.
Yes, because the same system is being used by the same organisation, I wouldn't expect to see any significant difference in the quality of the estimate for tax take for the UK as a whole. But Darren, you may want to answer that.
Thanks, Gareth. As Gareth says, there isn't an equivalent model, an estimate in the context of UK tax revenues, but there are other estimates which are really fundamental to preparation of the UK-wide trust statement, which records all of the tax revenues for the UK as a whole, where HMRC is required to, amongst other things, estimate the amount of revenue receivable at the end of the year. So that's for activity which has been undertaken, but tax returns haven't yet been submitted. And the 1%, I think, it's certainly not inconsistent. We would have to go away and have a look on an estimate by estimate basis. But the 1% we're talking about here is certainly not an outlier in that respect.
Looking specifically at the report, there's one or two areas I would just ask for a little bit of clarification on. As I say, right the way through the report, anybody reading this would have a concern at the level of estimations and so on. And I know that you consider a system in place is robust, but that's dependent on having a system to produce these estimates. You know, it's very difficult to get a grip of the facts in this. So let me ask one or two questions. On page 6, paragraph 4 of your report summary, you talk about the HMRC producing a provisional estimate of Scottish income tax revenue for that year. Is this in line with what you do for the for UK?
Well, I think this refers to our previous answer that there isn't an equivalent process for the UK where we audit how close HMRC's calculation of income taxes to a prior estimate, because clearly we're auditing the entire tax take for the purposes of the HMRC accounts. So our audit there is focused on the accuracy of the figures being disclosed in each year's annual accounts. Clearly, we pay a lot of attention to all the same issues around accurate identification of the income tax due, performance of the HMRC in collecting tax due, and the level of debt built up by taxpayers. So we do look at all of that. But as we've tried to explain, there isn't an equivalent process for estimating and then comparing outturn in the UK-wide accounts as the one we're discussing today. But all we would say is that what we observe is the same systems are being used consistently for UK tax, Scottish tax, and of course now Wales income tax as well.
Looking at, again, at your report, page 8, and I'm looking at paragraph 12 here, I find it astonishing that taxpayers don't have to bother advising a change of address. I mean, how can this system possibly be robust if people can just willy-nilly change addresses and vanish off the system? I realise that's not something within your powers, but...
Well, it's a feature of the UK tax system as a UK-wide, that clearly this will be up to Parliament if it wanted to legislate to make this a requirement on taxpayers, but it's clearly chosen not to. Most taxpayers would probably regard it in their interests to make sure they had accurate information going to and fro with HMRC. But as you say, it's something that HMRC needs to work around, and so they have this address cleansing process that we've described in the report and have covered in previous years, which is well established now, and the database of addresses is a key part of that cleansing process. And you know, as we've already discussed, it throws up data quality issues every year. Would making taxpayers responsible for updating HMRC with their address, it might help. I think it's still people who are determined to evade the system would, of course, still attempt to do that. It's not our role as auditors to recommend policy changes. It's we're kind of here to observe how the system is operating in practice and where the outstanding issues appear to lie.
Looking at paragraph 15, you state here HMRC estimates Scotland's share of net losses is 800 million, which is based on a proportion of the UK figure rather than Scotland specific data. So how exactly do they calculate that share of the net losses? Is it a percentage according to the number of the volume of taxpayers that we have here, and it's as simple as that, or is there some other esoteric formula?
Let me bring Darren in on this question.
Thanks, Gareth. So what you've described, Mr. Beatty, is broadly in line with our understanding of how this works. So I think the key thing to note here, and we do draw this out in the report, and I think in the written evidence that HMRC provided to a predecessor committee, signposted this, that at present there isn't a bottom-up assessment of compliance yield or tax at risk for Scotland. An assessment is made at the overall UK level of tax at risk through the strategic picture of risk, and the elements of that which are relevant to Scotland, i.e. non-savings, non-dividend aspects of the income tax regime, are the amounts attributable to Scotland are calculated based on, broadly speaking, Scotland's share of overall non-savings, non-dividend income compared to the UK as a whole.
Ron, in the report, you say that the dividend and savings are bound up in the income tax figure for the UK, which means that we're taking a proportion of that as part of the loss, which doesn't seem right.
It's probably worth clarifying here that this is essentially income foregone, not tax collected and then an amount attributed through the budget, an outturn relevant to Scotland. So this isn't an adjustment that HMRC make to Scottish income tax take in calculating the outturn. This is essentially income foregone.
So how do you account for that?
So in very basic terms, from an overall UK HMRC trust statement accounts perspective, it isn't accounted for in the accounts. This is essentially what the trust statement includes is income that has actually been assessed, the liabilities that have been established and amounts that have been recovered and reported by HMRC.
This is a notional figure. What's the purpose of it?
I think, like the tax gap assessment, which HMRC conducts at the overall UK level, and I think the last assessment based on 2019-20 data was a tax gap of around 35 billion. This is HMRC's estimate of what impact abuse and avoidance of the system is having on amounts that HMRC could in theory have collected but hasn't. Because of non-compliance and evasion and things of that nature.
Convener, I could go on, but I'm conscious that other members have questions as well. Perhaps I can come in later if there's time.
Yes, absolutely. And on that note, I will press on and ask Sharon Dowie to ask a number of questions that she's got. Sharon.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning. On compliance of Scottish income taxpayers, one issue that's arisen during the scrutiny in previous NO income tax reports has been whether there's been any emerging evidence of behavioural effects from Scottish income tax rates and bans diverging from those in the rest of the UK. So in 2020-21, Scottish taxpayers paid more income tax than taxpayers south of the border in earnings over £27,000. A difference in excess of £1,500 on those earning over £50,000 per annum. The NEO report states that HMRC continues to assess as low the risk of non-compliance, a result of divergence between Scottish income tax and the rest of the UK, and that HMRC has not identified any significant or widespread instances of taxpayers changing their address to obtain a tax advantage. Can I ask what the definition is of significant or widespread in this instance?
Well, it's essentially the concept of materiality that we use as auditors. So in other words, anything other than the odd case here or there. In fact, I'm not sure or aware of any cases, but Darren will correct me on this, where there's been a proven abuse through declaring a false address to avoid paying Scottish income tax. But we can obviously come back with any kind of further update on that. But in other words, there's no significant impact on the tax take set out in the outturn for Scotland of any of that behaviour. And we set out in para 2.36 of our report the three activities that HMRC undertakes to check that risk and to mitigate it and to pick up any examples should they start occurring. So we think that's a reasonable approach in view of the scale of the risk. But this is why we recommend, as does the Auditor General for Scotland, that this area is kept under particularly close attention, because clearly this is quite new, this divergence in tax rates. And so evasion behaviour may take some time to emerge in the system, and therefore I think a lot of attention needs to continue to be paid by this by HMRC.
Okay, thanks. Was Darren going in though? Thanks for that then. It's not causing concern just now then, but you're keeping an eye on it. The other one was, HMRC has limited performance data available about its compliance activities in Scotland. So unlike its income tax system, which flags residents as Scottish, HMRC's compliance system cannot readily identify people living in Scotland. HMRC therefore cannot easily track and monitor compliance activity in Scotland, and this affects its ability to collect performance data about the extent of Scottish non-compliance. Can I ask why is this the case, that there's limited performance data and compliance activities in Scotland, and what, if anything, is being done to address it?
Yep. Again, I will bring Darren in, who will have more detail to add. But I think the general point is that the data that identifies Scottish taxpayers for the purposes of self-assessment and PAYE, which we described there, so the S prefix on tax codes, that isn't available for the compliance systems to use in a routine fashion because of the design of those systems. And so it would require significant updating and replacement of compliance systems to be able to use the data that identified the country of the taxpayer in an automatic way. I think that's the central reason to explain why HMRC isn't able to do that at the moment. Now, clearly, if that became a big priority, that investment would, would be a good argument for prioritising the investment required to bring those systems up to date so that they could use that data automatically and efficiently. But Darren, do you have any further points to add to that?
Not much more to add. I think the key point here, as Gareth has outlined, is that the self-assessment and pay-as-you-earn systems do allow, through the S prefix, a good opportunity to identify the Scottish taxpaying population. The separate compliance systems which HMRC operates don't have an equivalent mechanism for identifying compliance activity undertaken in respect of Scottish taxpayers. I think in the written evidence that HMRC submitted to one of your predecessor committees, I think the conclusion they came to was that whilst it was possible to undertake that work, it was incredibly resource intensive and it wasn't something that they were intending to do at that point of time. So it was feasible and it was technically possible, but not practicable at this time. But as Gareth says, if there was a substantive need, and I know HMRC engages with the Scottish Government around the balance of compliance work and the activity it undertakes, and clearly that would come with a cost benefit consideration attached to it. I think the HMRC view would be it's possible, but it's not something that they currently do.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. And we are going to come on to questions around the cost of administering the Scottish Income Tax shortly. And I'm also going to come to Willie Coffey in a moment about the identification of Scottish S code taxpayers and how that all fits together. But before I do that, I want to invite Craig Hoy to ask a series of questions. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Davis. In your report, you look at the impact of COVID-19 on HMRC compliance activities, and you note that COVID has continued to have an impact on compliance and debt management. Across the UK, there were 29% fewer civil compliance cases opened and 26% fewer cases closed in 2020-21 than in 2019-2020. Just at the outset, just be interesting to get a snapshot in terms of your view. As to why that is that because internal processes in HMRC have been impacted by COVID, perhaps people working from home and therefore less capacity, or is it because the world outside has become more complex as a result of the pandemic?
I think the answer to that changed over the various phases of the pandemic. I think initially, yes, you're right, there was a big operation underway to equip HMRC staff to work from home, but probably more importantly, a diversion of some HMRC staff resource to the furlough scheme setup and delivery. If you remember how quickly that was stood up and delivered, it required the diversion of people who had previously been working on things like tax compliance to the furlough scheme. So I think understandable and probably the correct prioritisation of resources in that situation. And then as things developed, clearly, people could be taken off the furlough scheme as the numbers joining that scheme reduced. Some of the compliance activity was restarted, and the home working arrangements were bedding in. So they have been able to return, and they're now working, actually they're not just working at kind of full capacity in recent months on compliance activity, but have added to that because of the need to catch up on some of the activity that had to be postponed during those phases of the pandemic. So largely the resources of HMRC is the answer. Clearly on tax collection, taxpayer behaviour did change because they were given more time to pay. So tax debts did build up in many cases, as we've already discussed.
And do you have any concerns that, much in the same way that people who struggled to pay tax during that period are now paying the present tax, and therefore they've almost forgotten about that period, which may impede the recovery of that? Do you have a concern also that in capacity terms, HMRC is going to be so busy in the forward-looking work that we may end up not fully delving into that period retrospectively?
Well, HMRC gave some detailed evidence on this to the Public Accounts Committee in Westminster recently, based on the report I mentioned of ours, where we looked at the build-up of tax debt during the pandemic. And so I'm sure we can make that evidence available to the committee if you'd find that helpful. What they described there was a recovery plan, essentially, for bringing down the level of tax debt steadily. So they have targets for doing that. They can show how they deployed their resources to achieve those targets, and they're making steady progress. But yes, the questioning of the committee was, as you would expect, quite challenging on the speed at which that could be recovered, bearing in mind that the longer a debt stays outstanding, the harder it is to collect. So that's work in progress. I think HMRC would say that they are hitting their milestones for bringing the total debt down, but there's a long way to go.
But you would expect there to be an upscaling of those activities in relation to compliance and debt management as we come out of the pandemic?
Well, there has been already, and there has been. And so the question is getting that balance between staying on top of current collections and then tackling the backlog. And at some point, there will be a question about is there an amount that has to be essentially written off, but we're not close to that point yet.
And just in relation to, we talked about a separate analysis of Scottish compliance and saying that perhaps the effort would be too great and the cost might be too great. Do you have any insight as to whether or not there are plans for analysis of Scottish income tax debt becoming available? Is that work that is being undertaken at all? And is it something, do you think, that the Scottish Government, HMRC or yourself would benefit from?
I don't think, I mean, Darren will correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I don't think there is any work underway on that we're aware of. And again, it's back to prioritisation of HMRC's resources, which, as I understand it, they're not currently prioritising that kind of analysis. But Darren, is that your understanding as well?
That's in line with my understanding. I think this is certainly a topic which has been discussed with our colleagues over at HMRC, and there are benefits to disaggregating debt compliance and other data based on sectors and regions, and that would be important and valuable management information, but I'm not aware that there are any plans to do that for Scotland at the present time.
Fine, just in your opening remarks, or perhaps just after, Mr. Davis, you said in relation to income tax debt attributable to Scotland that there was no reason to predict that it would be at any different levels to the rest of the UK. I'm just wondering how you could come to that conclusion if there has been no substantive analysis so far been conducted.
Well, it wasn't a kind of assertion that would be an accurate measure. It was more, we're not aware of any, nobody's put to us any reasons why there would be different behaviour on that in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK.
Finally, if I could just ask one quick question of Mr. Boyle, if I can, just in relation to your report. You noted that further analysis of taxpayer behaviour, along with the relative success of compliance activity in Scotland and Scotland's specific tax gap, would help the Scottish Government to assess whether any Scottish income tax compliance risks are emerging. I was just wondering, Mr. Boyle, if you have any concept or could elaborate on what those risks might be and the scale of them, potentially.
Thanks, Mr. Hoy. I think what we're setting out in our report here is, I think, along the lines of the conversation we've had this morning, that as the tax policy choices of the respective governments diverge, and then this is captured in the NEO's report, I think that illustrates by bands some of the percentage differentials now of different incomes that the taxpayers might have, and that, that might then inform, you know, some of the behaviour choices that taxpayers make as they identify themselves through their employer or self-identification as Scottish taxpayers. As this increases further, if it increases further, the different tax choices of the respective parliaments, that there is further risk potential of non-compliance, non-identification, and by extension, in due course, a potential threat to the Scottish budget. I think as we set out in our report, that we think it's important that this is kept under review, that there's an opportunity for non-compliance, and you know, it is one of the risks that HMRC will need to manage along with its interaction with the Scottish Government.
The risk would potentially be somebody buying a bolt hole in Berwick-upon-Tweed and registering themselves there, despite working in Edinburgh, for example.
I think, I mean, that is the you know, the classic example, I suppose. But the, you know, and through our own work and supporting the NEO's conclusions, that it's not a material risk currently, okay, but that the potential remains, and potentially that risk will grow if the two parliaments continue to make different choices, yeah, about what the tax bans and how those are applied.
Fine, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. But just to confirm, there has been no flight of income taxpayers from Scotland to England that you've got any evidence of, Auditor General?
Certainly, it's perhaps more a question for the CNAG convener, actually, but I think for our own work, we're not identifying any specific, you know, pattern of behaviour, but rather that's a growing risk. And if I may refer back to Mr. Beattie's earlier question about the postcode element of it and the increasing number without postcodes, and whilst also agreeing that there's not a significant risk necessarily, I think there is a point about equity that we touch on in our report, that really Scottish-based taxpayers ought to be identified, ought to be paying and contributing through to the Scottish budget. And we also note in our own report that there's perhaps an opportunity for HMRC to perhaps set a target for a low number of missing Scottish postcodes through its own work. So that's part of our own findings on this work.
OK, thank you. I'm going to now turn to Willie Coffey, who this morning is joining us virtually. And I know Willie has got a number of questions he wants to put, so over to you.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Davis, Mr. Stewart and Mr. Boyle. Probably the first comment to make or to note that we know that 54% of Scottish taxpayers actually pay less in income tax than they would do if they lived in other parts of the UK. But nevertheless, the issue about identifying Scottish taxpayers is an issue for us. We note that in 2020, HMRC identified over 30,000 taxpayers' records that were not recorded as Scottish as in S codes. But in March 2021, this actually rose to 39,000. So a couple of questions around that, if I may, to Mr. Davis and his colleague. Why is that happening? A simple calculation might show that that could represent £1 billion in earnings that are being incorrectly taxed. So could you just tell us, give us a little flavour of why you think these numbers are going up so significantly and what's being done to try and reduce that figure?
Yes, of course. I mean, I think the first thing to say is on these particular ones, because I think you're referring to the numbers on the administration of the tax codes with the S prefix here. Actually, in June 2019, there were 67,500 cases. That was down by April 2020, so a year later, 67,500 to 31,000. HMRC identified 31,400 taxpayer records, which was about 1.3% of cases where employers were not operating a tax code with an S prefix. And then by March 21, so the most recent data we have, that was around about 39,000 cases. So it came down from a higher level in 2019, but it's still, as you say, it's still a kind of worryingly significant number that needs to be addressed. I think I would go back to my previous comments when we were talking about postcodes here rather than tax codes. And I think the same general point applies here, which is this is an issue of data quality in a large system. And so that just requires permanent vigilance. So testing the quality of the data to ensure that where there should be an S prefix, there is, identifying any exceptions, trying to understand why they are occurring. And if that shows that there's a weakness in the system, then correcting that weakness. That is a continuous process for good management of any large data system like this. And so our approach will be to, first of all, monitor the performance. So is that number going up or down? Secondly, to find out from HRRC, are they identifying any systemic reasons for this level of error system? And thirdly, what are they doing about those if they have identified them? So I think that's our role in this continuous vigilance process is what's being done to ensure this data quality is as high as possible, recognising there will always be an error rate. The challenge is to make that error rate as small as possible.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Is there any estimate of the loss of revenue as a result of this? We were also reading in our briefing notes that some employers might repeatedly be failing to apply the S codes directly, and we don't have any information on that. And I could ask you if you have any other employers who are repeatedly not doing this, and fundamentally that's against the law not to apply this code correctly, isn't it? So is there any estimate of the loss of revenue, and what are we doing to, let's say, encourage employers to apply the code correctly and legally?
I don't think we have a specific estimate on this element of the, I mean, this forms part of that overall, which my colleague, Mr. Stewart, was describing the overall figure for leakage from the system, if you like, earlier on. So I don't think we have a specific estimate for this particular element of it. But you're right, I think there is an issue with what action is being taken for persistent offenders, employers that are persistently found to be not either not doing this accurately or at all, because we haven't been able to get a clear answer on the approach being taken to that small number of employers yet. But we are going to follow that up with HMRC in our work on the next year's figures.
Okay. You'll probably recall as well, Mr. Davis, that in the early days of this, even some of our own MSPs in the Scottish Parliament were not coded as Scottish taxpayers. I think the number was 45 MSPs out of 129, that's a huge number to get wrong. Can you give us an assurance that that problem has now been corrected completely and that the 129 of us, and indeed our 59 Scottish MP colleagues, are being correctly coded as Scottish taxpayers?
We believe that kind of embarrassing position has been corrected, because it's obviously something we've paid attention to, having highlighted it in a report several years ago. There was some focused action taken. In fact, a kind of a manual check was applied by HMRC to exactly that group of people that you mentioned, to avoid it recurring. Our finding so far is that that's been successful, that exercise, and they've maintained that level of accuracy since then. But I think it's because of that, the significance of the issue at the time, I think that remains on HMRC's radar.
Thank you. I'm glad to say I wasn't one of the 45. I was correctly identified initially. given that we've got you in front of us, Mr. Davis, I wonder if you could say something or anything about the audit function that might apply to the UK government's Shared Prosperity Fund when it comes in. As you probably know, the European Union structural funds were completely under the scope and gaze of Audit Scotland and the Scottish Parliament, and we don't have any details about the follow-up arrangements that will apply with respect to either the Levelling Up Fund or the Shared Prosperity Fund, whatever it's called for Scotland. Do you have any information from an audit perspective of where that audit function will rest? Because we think the value of that money to Scotland and the Scottish Parliament is about over £1 billion over 7 years. And we've no idea if it's going to be the same amount, but it's the audit function I'm asking you specifically about rather than the politics of it. Do you have any information you can share with the committee?
Not in any detail about how that will operate, not yet, no. So we We obviously will be discussing that with our colleagues in Audit Scotland. We work very closely together, the Auditor General and I, on all of these matters where we have functions that either abut each other or overlap with each other. So I'm confident that between us we will be able to explain clearly the audit arrangements that are proposed for each of those funds. We're just not clear yet because the government in Westminster hasn't got to that level of detail. But I agree, it's a really important issue for kind of clear accountability to the relevant parliament. But rest assured that we work very closely together, the two audit officers, to input our views on what's practical and feasible from an audit perspective. Clearly, the policy questions are not for us, but the practical administration of an effective audit regime is. So we will be inputting our thoughts into that as we get to that point.
Would you just have any indication of when we all might know? Because we've been asking this question several audit committees over recent weeks. Is there any indication of when we'll be clearer about it?
I can't give you a useful date, I'm afraid, but clearly that both of those funds are moving through the legislative process, that they will require answers to that question about the audit arrangements, but I can't give you a date, I'm afraid.
Okay. Many thanks for those responses. Back to you, Convener. Thank you.
Thanks to Willie. We do have, I think, a little bit of time on our hands, and I think Colin Beattie wanted to come back in with a couple more questions before we wind up just looking at the cost of administering the Scottish income tax system. But I'm going to invite Colin to come back in.
Thank you, Convener. Referring back to our previous discussion, I'd refer you to page 17, paragraph 1.23, where there are four bullet points there that I find very telling in terms of the robustness of the figures around Scottish income tax. And they clearly, to me, indicate that there is a real problem in calculating that. Now, if you look at bullet point three, we were talking before about this 800 million notional. I mean, here it says quite clearly that the figures that are being used here do not exclude tax from savings and dividend income. Now, that can't, using those figures, you can't possibly get something accurate out of that, because you know that's not within the Scottish Government's tax authority, if you like. And again, on bullet point two, the two different proportions, the different proportions of taxpayer north and south of the border, is completely distorted, because you've got the City of London and so on, which massively is overrepresented in terms of the top income taxpayers. And we don't have that in Scotland. So if we're simply using a methodology to calculate this, which is based on that kind of incredible difference, how can the figures possibly be accurate?
Well, I think this is a methodology question at heart, isn't it? And I think this is a question that the governance arrangements between HMRC and the Scottish Government will need to continue to address. You're making perfectly valid points, of course, about the limitations that these factors bring into the process. They are all agreed elements of the methodology at the moment. So it's not as if this is being done somehow in a way that isn't known and visible to both parties here, so Scottish Government and HMRC. So I think this is a matter, it may be that the committee would like to take evidence from both Scottish Government and HMRC on this question. Are these factors under consideration in discussion about future methodology improvements? What would be required to be able to address these issues? And again, I think as we've said on a number of points, it'd be for HMRC to answer that question, not me, but I think I'm sure they would say this is a question of cost-benefit analysis. So what would be the extent of the improvement if we were able to disaggregate data in this way? And what's the cost of being able to do that? And you're right that this should be continually scrutinised, because this process needs to improve over time. If there is a cost-effective way of eliminating some of these essentially rough elements of the estimation process, then of course that should be something that the governance arrangements in place between the two parties consider.
Just on to one or two specifics, page 10, paragraph 1.2, it says here that the HMRC calculates the final outturn figure from several components. It doesn't actually mention what these components are. I don't know how lengthy a response will be to try and explain them. If it's short, fine. If not, maybe you can drop us a note on that.
Darren, is that straightforward to answer now, or should we write with a bit more detail?
I think we could follow up in writing, but I would, in the first instance, I would point to figure 3 in the report. So this is on page 12. So that does signpost the different elements which form the calculations. So extractions from the self-assessment and pay-as-you-earn systems, and then some of the estimates and adjustments that are made to arrive at the outturn.
Again, turning to
very
page...
Very happy to write with an expansion on that figure.
That'd be excellent. Page 11, paragraph 1.5, says here, in some areas of calculation, data are not available in sufficient detail to identify income tax liabilities, reliefs or other adjustments relating to individual taxpayers. Again, that's a huge estimate to make.
Well, in financial terms, compared to the overall estimate, it's not significant. And I think this is that small number of people for where, essentially, where HMRC doesn't have access to the data because of various sensitivities. But this is not a material financial element of the estimate in that case.
And again, I mean, it's a theme running all the way through here about estimates and assumptions. And I mean, again, on page 13, paragraph 1.11, HMRC deducts an estimate of the Scottish share of tax reliefs given against PAYE liabilities. How do they reach that figure? What's it based on? Is it based on some of the flawed data that you highlighted in paragraph 1.23?
Yeah, again, HMRC would be able to set out the detail of that, but I think it is in the same category as others we've just been discussing, which is to improve it would require more detailed information than they currently hold in their systems. And so it's then a trade-off between the cost of collecting that more detailed information and the benefit of a more accurate estimate.
And again, on page 14, paragraph 1.16, HMRC calculated both deductions by estimating the Scottish share of each tax relief claimed across the UK using historical data. I don't know what that historical data is.
Well, it means from previous years rather than from the year that we're discussing here. But again, I think all of these points, actually, it may be that the committee would like to take evidence directly from HMRC, because these are clearly operational issues for HMRC themselves. They're not essentially, our role as the auditor here is to point out where there are estimates and the limitations on the accuracy of the data within our overall conclusion that this is a robust...
I accept your point there. I'm trying to highlight, though, the issues around the uncertainties around the figures that are being produced. Sorry, I'm just flicking through your report here, which was an excellent bedtime read. According to page 21, paragraph 2.13, HMRC confirmed the residence status of 92% of Scottish and Welsh pension scheme members, and provisionally estimates 94% have been confirmed following the 2021 tax year. That seems doesn't seem a high proportion. I mean, pension scheme members should be easy to pick up, you would think. That seems a quite a low proportion.
Yes. I don't think it's out of line with the UK-wide figures on that. And actually, tracing pensioners is it's a big exercise for pension schemes themselves as well, of course, because they need to know that pensioners are still alive, apart from anything else, and therefore they should still be paying the pension. So this is an area where I think that there may be further developments in data matching between different parts of government who have an interest in accurately locating pensioners. But again, this is another example where there may be available improvements as data becomes easier to match. The question is, how much resource would that take, and what would the benefit be in financial terms of doing that?
On page 23, given that it's known that in Scotland there's a higher proportion of people than in the rest of the UK give to charity, in paragraph 2.14, says HMRC don't have systems in place to establish the residency of taxpayers donating to charity. I mean, all these anomalies add up. You may say that one of them is a very small impact, but when you actually look at them in the aggregate, it starts to become a concern.
Yeah, I think this is it's a long agenda for the governance arrangements between the Scottish Government and HMRC that considers how this methodology could be improved over time. So I think you're pointing out perfectly valid items for that agenda.
Convener, I could go on, but I'm conscious of time.
Right. Thank you very much. Well, look, I mean, I guess I just want to try to capture the essence of some of the things we've been saying. And I have to say, Mr. Davis, this is not pointed at you or Darren Stewart either. It's because we are trying to understand where there are gaps and where improvements can be made. And I guess we reflect that this is kind of year 4-5 of the distinctive Scottish income tax system. And yet, even at this stage, we don't have Scotland-specific tax gap data about the amount that should be paid versus what is actually paid. We don't have Scotland-specific data on compliance or non-compliance. There is no Scotland-specific data on income tax debt, all of which we've been probing this morning. And you're right, it may well be that that's around the arrangement, the service level agreement that's in place between the Scottish Government and HMRC, and I think we need to consider whether that would be a useful avenue for us to explore further. I mean, do you get a sense that there would be scope, because we've heard in previous years, and to some extent we're hearing again today, that this is also about the limited resources that HMRC has got. I mean, if the service level agreement was adjusted, would it be possible to get that information, that data, disaggregated to a Scottish level that would help inform the decisions that this Parliament needs to make around income tax rates, as well as gaining an understanding of the revenues that will be generated by the rates that are set?
Very keen, that you don't think I'm dodging the question, but I think only HMRC can give you a useful answer to that, because they understand what would be involved in improving the various elements of the data we've been discussing. So they would be able to explain the resource implications of different approaches here, and so I couldn't give you a useful answer on that. Obviously, as an auditor, I'm keen on accurate figures. So the more that some of these estimates can be reduced in variability, better the database for arriving at the figures, the better from an audit point of view. But clearly, I think you do need HMRC to describe what would be required to deliver the improvements that you've been discussing.
Okay, but just to be clear, you say in the report that your assessment is that the £0.7 million administration fee is accurate and fair in the context of the agreement between HMRC and the Scottish Government. So, for our benefit, could you tell us what you mean by fair?
Yes. Our starting point for that is the service level agreement that's been negotiated between the Scottish Government and HMRC. So, what we've examined is the information that HMRC have given us for the costs of implementing that service level agreement. So we can see how they've attributed staff costs and IT costs and so on to carrying out the work required under the SLA. And we think that calculation is supported by the data that we've seen, and we think that it's a fair estimate of what the time and other costs involved in operating the agreement. Clearly, if you had a more highly specified agreement that got into some of the areas we've been talking about here, it's likely that HMRC would require more cost to be able to do that. But on the basis of the agreement as it's currently set out, we think that's fairly stated.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, on that note, I will conclude the session and thank Stephen Boyle, the Auditor General, who's joined us in person in the committee today, Mark Taylor, who was on hand to answer any questions that we had for him, but I don't think in the event Mark was called upon, but thank you anyway, and a particular thanks to Gareth Davis and to Darren Stewart from the NAO, and we, as I said at the beginning, we do very much hope to see you in person at some point in the future, because I think that would help us to examine the important role that you've got in you know, keeping account of how the HMRC is functioning in this area that is obviously of particular concern and importance to us. So thank you for answering our questions, and we look forward to seeing you at some point in the not too distant future. Thank you, and I now draw the public part of this morning's committee to a close. Thank you.